So everything is recorded and will be available on YouTube probably by tomorrow. Yes, so we have invited three speakers to provide a presentation today. And you can see here our guest speakers, Dr. Uwe Zscherpel from the BAM in Berlin, with a very interesting topic about the revision of the ISO 14096, followed by Pavel Zaitsev, who is showing some ideas about live application of NDT packs. And last but not least, we have our new news member, Dr. Masloum from Egypt, who is will be addressing the introduction to digitization and computerized radiography. Yeah, let's just get started. Dr. Zscherpel, I will make you, you are co-host, so you we should be able to...
Andere verhindern. Okay.
Okay.
Do you see something?
Yep, you are right there. And it's,
I see nothing on my screen. Just a moment. Let's see if it will work. Now, I see it good.
Yes, and please take your time. I mean, we're going to be not cutting you off, or you want to be shorter or longer. Go ahead.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, good afternoon from Berlin here. Nice sunshine outside. I will speak on image quality industrial radiography. And I'm not looking from a commercial side. I'm looking from the side of security, safety. Because our institute, which has this year the 150th year anniversary, is working since about nearly 90 years in radiographic testing of industrial products. And one of the major outcomes of our institute, besides test reports you can order, is active work in standardization gremia. And I'm a member of, and meanwhile also convener of, a series of standardization committees. All of them are connected with industrial radiology and nowadays digital industrial radiology. And you see it here. Yeah, but today I want to speak a little bit on the problems you have if you digitize industrial X-ray films. The film itself looks very similar to a medical one, but if you have a film from a weldment, here I used our famous test weld BAM5, which is 8 millimeter of steel and contains a lot of cracks and indications. And you scan this with a medical film scanner, you get the result on the left side. And you don't see so much. And the problem is that these films in NDT are different than the films you are used to have in medical. What is the basic difference? Basic difference is the dose response. In medical, you look for the human being, and we learned in the last 100 years that the human being is very sensitive to radiation dose. Therefore, the dose during an investigation at the doctors should be as low as possible. Result is that the film is not very dark by the X-rays. And the result, a typical film density range in medical is between 0 and 3. In NDT, your pipeline has no problems with X-rays. And therefore, you can use dose ranges for your investigation 1,000 times higher than in medical. And this gives a much higher signal to noise ratio in your image. You can use different film system screens for amplification, and this gives much higher sharpness. And the result is you need also an adapted film digitization system for your NDT film. And if you have an adapted film system digitization system, then you have the result here on the right side here, where you clearly see all the crack indications, you see the IQIs, and typically I showed here the images as high-pass filtered images that you can see on the screen something, and profiles here along these black lines, I show the raw data. And then you see here, you see the welding seam, and across the welding seam, you have here in dark, here the incomplete penetration where material is missing. And then you have here lower light after the film. That means a higher absorption because the film has a higher optic density, because you get a higher signal. Absorption is here missing from the X-rays. And also, if you look at the baseline, you see here nicely the wires. This is a typical image quality identifier, which was, by the way, developed at BAM 1935, so 80-90 years ago. Because it's boring for the inspector if you have only welds and no flaws in the welds, but you had to detect something. So the idea was to add, by intention, some wires with known diameter on the weld perpendicular, and then you can identify the wires and you can look for the finest wire you can see in your image. And this gives then a good measure for the sensitivity of your system. And here with the NDT scanner from DuPont, which was developed in 1997 already, this was the first system adapted to NDT films. And if you compare this to the response of a typical medical scanner, which has also 15 bit and goes up to density of 3, but here we have a film with a density of 4.52, and therefore you cannot see anything with this scanner. So you need a special scanner for your special NDT films. Yeah, and to support the industry and the user and all the community, we decided together with EPRI, the Electric Power Research Institute in North Carolina in the US, which is the responsible institute for flaw detection and image quality in the field of nuclear technique in the US. We developed together a so-called EPRI test film, which has a full width of optical densities between 0.5 and 4.5, which are important for non-destructive testing, and a lot of objects for measuring of spatial resolution and sharpness and so on. And this allows then to test your scanning equipment. And the full thing was then finally, first it comes into an ASTM standard. ASTM is always the fastest in the world. In 97, we had the ASTM standard already fixing the design of the test film. And then we had the European standard 14096 in 2003. And here are the title given. NDT is a qualification of your systems for digitization. And the first part is the definition and the image quality and the standard reference film, which is this EPRI film, and quality control. And part two is then the minimum requirements for your daily applications. And so this was first published by CEN in Europe and later taken over by ISO, so the same text, but it was taken over as a separate ISO standard. And so some of you may have noticed this. In 2020, we had a new edition, but this was just a merged version of the two separated standards without any technical change. So there's only a new number and now it's combined, but the contents is still the old contents from 2003. And beginning with this year, I took over the convenership of the ISO standard committee, responsible for radiographic testing. And I plan that we do an official technical revision of this standard, which is now more than 15 years unchanged on the market, which is relatively long for a standard. And we plan to start a revision next year. Why next year? It's simple, because the ISO committee normally meets once each 4 years when the World Conference happens. And the World Conference was planned for 2020 in South Korea, at the capital and the airport is in Shinon or something like this, the name. And this is shifted because of Corona, and typically the first shift was just this week, but I'm sitting still in Berlin, so it's already shifted again. And now the next shift is in February 22. And then we will meet also at this ISO committee. And I plan to have an official technical revision because we want to correct some ISO text errors, which was taken over here at this time. And we had about 20 years of development, and all the other digital standards, they just use for characterization of the sharpness of the digital image, now a new term, which is called basic spatial resolution. And this term is calculated from the MTF of an edge, but at 10%. And in our old standard, EN5 standard, we have the MTF measured at 20%. And so, and we have also given a pixel size. So these things must be adjusted to update this to state of the art. And then we have had to have some improved reporting of scanning times and artifacts, because scanning times is a major issue. We have different scanning technologies. Some are faster, some are slower, and dust and stray lights are also different handled. And so this should be reported according to a standard. And but in principle, no changes are necessary. No? The standard is still accepted by the industry and useful for the characterization of the scanning equipment of NDT films. So if you have any suggestion what we should consider for the future revision, here's my email. You are open to send me some suggestions, or in the typical standardization channels, of course, it's also possible. And this is my task, where I, as BAM here, support the development and application of standards by, for example, certification, which I come later. Here are some numbers now of the second part on the minimum requirements. And the minimum requirements, that means we defined, when we made the standard, we defined three digitalization classes. There's a basic class, DA, and you see this is a density range where you had to work with, but you had to have in mind that this is not only a density of 3.5, which must be digitized, but you should have also a density contrast sensitivity here of 0.02 in the whole range here. So this is the problem. These two requirements together, the requirements of 10 or 12 bits, this is now old. The technology, all the things I have seen in the last years are 60 bit or more. So this is not any problem anymore, but the physical requirement is a density contrast sensitivity, which you have to have in this range. And this density contrast sensitivity comes not just from the heaven. It's a result of a huge investigation, which was done long ago, where the, it was done in the 1940s to 1960s, where people investigated what is the minimum size or the minimum contrast you can identify with your naked eye. And different researchers in different parts of the world, they all came to the unique result that the optical density difference of 0.02 is this what you can see with your eye on a film. So, in the best case, you can be better, or you can be worse, but not better. And so if you want to have a scanner which scans your film and delivers digital data, then the scanner should, of course, see the same sensitivity that you see with your naked eye. And so this value comes from, and these are the different density ranges you had to work. And then you have it's a second part, a table two here with a lot of numbers on the spatial resolution. The idea from these numbers comes from also a very old investigation. Sachen Klaasens was a researcher at Philips Laboratories, and he published in 1946 a paper on unsharpness in scintillators and on edges. So you expose a sharp edge and you measure the edge on your film or your digital detector nowadays. And then you see that the sharp edge is no longer sharp and it extends to some unsharpness. And here are the different unsharpness values in micrometers, which you obtain if you change the energy of your film or you change the wall thickness, because the material of the wall will filter the low energy and you have only high energies. And this will give a higher inner unsharpness in the film. And these film values here you get from such edge unsharpness measure is also here now by a factor of 2. You have to give an unsharpness of 30 micrometers, you need to have 2 pixels of 50 micrometers. So this corresponds easily. Also this here. So this is the best class. And then you have some loss of image quality to get a simpler, a cheaper equipment and faster scanning for the lower classes. But the best class, digital archivement class, where you can throw away the film, needs to resolve the unsharpness of the film. And so you have here your eye, which gives the limit, and here the inner unsharpness of the film, which gives the limit, and sets these values. And these are realized and recognized values nowadays, and there's no need to change them. Yeah. What do you have for equipment for scanning? Here's some taken out from our training material, which we typically have. You can have a laser scanner, which makes a point by point digitization. Here with a red laser, which is, for example, the old Lumisys, or here's the array system, which is realizing such an approach. Then you can have a CCD or a CMOS detector as a line camera, and you can digitize a line and transport the film line by line across the sensor here. Or you can do the simplest thing, you use a normal light box and you use a CCD camera, or nowadays a CMOS camera. Sony has nice CMOS cameras with 16-bit and a few frames per second in 60 megapixel resolution. So this is much more than you need for radiography. So you can digitize very nicely here a complete film in a few seconds. But the problem is the calibration, and you need to do some high dynamic range digitization to cover the complete density range from 0 to 5. So a typically application will also need that you protect the environment of light. So we in the lab, we cover here the whole unit by a black cloth, like an old photographer. And then we have no surrounding light here, and we see only the light from the film itself. And we use such a drum scanner, which we also have in our lab here. This is from the pre-printing industry, but it completely disappeared from the market because everything in pre-press is nowadays digital. So we have still this drum scanner running, which has a very high spatial resolution. And we use this scanner to scan a series of ASTM films. They have a nice collection of reference radiographs for castings, for weldments, for different wall thicknesses, different materials, titanium, steel, aluminium, brass, and so. So that's the casting guys, that they can use them to evaluate their castings, their radiographs from the castings. And nowadays, also radiography is done by electronic means, by the digital detector arrays and so on. And so the old catalogs had to be converted into digital electronic reference catalogs. And we did the task for ASTM, and we scanned here on such a drum. We glued the large casting films and scanned them with 10 micrometer resolution. And in 20 minutes, we get 2 gigabytes of data. So this is the range of technology available for film digitization. And now, as an institute, we provide several certification programs. This is my major task here I have in the institute. And these are based on image quality parameters of various detectors for industrial radiographic inspection. So we, since 2000, we have a certification program for entity film characterization. So there's an ISO standard which describes how the film is characterized. And finally, the granularity, the noise in the film is measured with such a scanning microscope here. And at the top, I have an image of this microscope. And so we have, meanwhile, a series of companies which have certificates from our institute that say fulfill the film system classes according to the ISO standards. And since 2006, we do also such test sample set certificates for image plate systems, also computed radiography is a correct name in NDT. And we realized meanwhile 50 certificates, which has each 4 years of duration, and also on a worldwide base, all the major manufacturers. Here is a German manufacturer, which is Dürr NDT. And you can see here a small label that this is BAM certified for the image quality. And there are an ISO standard, and also ACM has some specification on the standards. And there's also, of course, a Zen standard, but the Zen standard is already transported to ISO. So in Europe, we prefer to go directly to ISO and not to make any separate standards. And our major task we have here at BAM is to go to ACM to ensure that the ACM standards have also the same requirements as the ISO standards, so that we have in different parts of the world always the same requirements. Yeah, and we have another system running since 2016 for digital detector arrays. This is one point of digital radiography, but digital radiography is everything. This is film digitization, this is computed radiography, and this is digital detector arrays. This is and so we separate the different items here. So we have one for films, one for CR, one for DDAs, and a very new one on request of one manufacturer. So we installed now a new certification program on film digitization systems, but up to now, there's no BAM certificate because we are still working on the first, but it's not yet released. And so from time to time, I hear this film scanner is BAM certified, but this is not true because we never released any certificate. Good. So we have a new certification program on X-ray film digitizing systems for digital industrial radiology. Yeah, what is the starting point? We get the first experience with the film digitization in NDT with the project Trend. It was here from 93 to 95. And we had a nice consortium, and BAM was a project leader, and then we had DuPont. I've shown you already one of the images from this NDT scan manager. We had Siemens Power Generation, which want to apply the film digitization for their films from turbine blades, which is a very high safety issue. And Telekom was also involved, the German company, because Telekom at this time, where the internet just starts, provides a glass fiber line between BAM and Siemens, and we were able to transform digital images, which is just today a part of Dicondi, but this was at this time just research. Yeah, and then we did also the Zen group for film digitization standardization. It was published in 2003. ISO did it, and we plan a new revision in 2002. And the problem I already showed is that at first there's commercial equipment available for medical, but NDT films are totally different. They have higher optical densities up to 5. They have low noise, typically SNR ranges. The inspectors in NDT work is between 100 and 300, so that you don't see any noise with your naked eye on your film. Therefore, it was very big, demanding at the beginning to explain NDT inspectors, there's noise in your image because they don't see the noise with they look with a naked eye on a plain film, an NDT. In medical, it's different because here the SNR, the medical film range is between 20 and 40. You see very easily the noise in your film. But this is accepted by the physicians because you cannot have such high X-ray doses with the human body. And therefore, they make a compromise. We don't have this compromise in NDT, and therefore we have different films with much more silver and therefore much more higher densities. And this should give the limit for the film scanning equipment, and therefore we have the standard with this minimum requirement as I explained. Yeah, and since 2003, I found we have basically only one commercial device from Array. I think I have the third version in my lab now with USB, before with SCSI interface, but it's very stable and running fine. And the wider system, I was in contact with them over 20 years, but this was not a comparison in image quality, this Array system. So I apologize. It looks much better with Microtech now, and we are in the process to generate a nice report for them. Yeah, the question is still in 2020, we have 70% of all industrial radiographic testing worldwide film-based. So if you want to go to industry 4.0, we need a lot of digitization with the films. And I think, Anna, this is still not my last thing. I want to summarize our activities again, okay? We have three reference procedures which we provided for the industry for worldwide application. We have the NDT film characterization, we have the digital detectors, and here we have in the reference procedure also included the film scanners as a digital detector, because it converts the analog film image into digital image data. And then we have a special item, which is also interesting. It's sold by our institute since more than 50 years, I think. It's a reference material, and it's a step wedge with 15 different fields of optical densities. And here you can see, I used this step wedge here for calibration of the scanner. No? You can scan the film which comes from us with a calibrated optical density chart, and then you can use to generate your lookup table and to calibrate the scanner such a, you can use this, yeah. This is the items which we do the certification. We have a special certification body here at BAM. This is not my task. And in this way, we do realize our production model. First, we have the premium normative research. We get some support from industry, from the European Union or other German funds. Then after this research is done, we do some development of standards. And finally, if the standards are published, we can do testing according to standards and finally certification. So this is how BAM is earning money back from the spend a lot of money for research, and then something should go back. And standardization also nobody pays. This is paid by German tax money, I think. Standardization in RT is also going on the major channels here. All digital activities started at ASTM. This is also interesting. The American society is much faster than the others. And therefore we go to ASTM, to support the German industry, because German industry is major export industry. And so we have nowadays a worldwide acceptance and for the globalized world. And therefore we had to go to ASTM, and just in 1 hour, I will switch over to the ASTM standardization meeting, which is in this week, but I'm still in Berlin. Okay, yeah. BAM has been recognized, okay, as authority for image quality and so on. Here you see I'm not sure if this is distorted by the images of the people, but here you see an image of the IQI, which was developed in our institute 1935, firstly standardized, and this is now as a DIN wire going around the world. And the image I showed on the web had also such DIN wires on it. Yeah, and this wire was defined in a standard, and this was just 2 pages. And we are just doing the new ISO version of this standard on web inspection and IQIs. And now we have not 2 pages, but 2 parts. Part one is film, part two is digital, altogether 200 pages. So this is developed a lot. And nowadays, artificial intelligence and flaw detection and metrology in computed tomography and laminography, is this called smart RT. These are now the new research areas for us, but we will still actively support safety relevant issues like the NDT film digitization for safe applications by research, testing and certification. Yeah, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Zscherpel. Now we would first ask the audience if there are any questions, and I think we are very good in time. So best way is to use the chat window if the audience has a question for Dr. Zscherpel.
No, I had to leave in half an hour. So sorry.
No problem. I think that we scheduled like 10 minutes, so that should be fine. So please, if there's any questions also from the other presenters, if you do have a question, please let know the right time to ask. Okay, we will make this presentation available on our YouTube channel.
Yeah.
So I think this is very good. It should be uploaded later today. So thank you very much. I ask again for the last time, any questions from the audience to Dr. Zscherpel? Okay, then I would say let's move on to the next presentation. Dr. Zscherpel, thank you so much for taking the time in your time zone the afternoon. Really appreciate it. Well, there is one question. Let me see. The question is, till now is only half an hour has been passed with the session. Yes. We didn't need more than 30 minutes. So like I said, if someone has missed something, we will provide this later on our YouTube channel and let you know. Whoever is registered for this conference will get the notification and the link.
Okay.
We will continue now with Iberisoft, Mr. Pavel Zaitsev, who is going to show us. Give me 1 second. I'm just switching here. Pavel, if you can I'll make you the host for the moment, just to make sure that.
Okay. Yeah, I can share my screen. Thank you.
Yeah, you can. Okay. And let me just introduce a little bit who has been following.